Everybody. I hope you're doing well this morning with the joy of the Lord, huh? Got the joy of the Lord this morning? I'm wondering. I'm a little nervous, though. I hope you do, because we have a great God, and we're gathered here to be able to worship Him today. We're glad you're here with us. We have a couple of announcements we want to get to you, so you can take advantage of the various ministries that are going on here at Berean. First of all, we have a number of prayer groups that meet throughout the week. We have a Wednesday night prayer group that meets here at 7. We have an afternoon prayer group that meets here on Wednesdays at 1 o'clock. We have a prayer group that meets in the morning on Thursday at 6 a.m. Yeah, ouch, right? That one's an early morning one. So there are a number of prayer groups going on that you can come out and be a part of, something in just about all the different time zones there. Now, why are those prayer groups important? Well, they're important because when you have like a major episode going on in your life, you mean, or you know, something you know really bad happens, or just something joyful, and you're like, "Hey, I need people to pray for me." What's those prayer groups that you mean are praying? And it's great to be able to have you know, people to come out to bring the needs of the church before the Lord. And if you're interested in getting involved in the prayer ministry, it's really important. You know, we can have great music, we can have, you know, great sermons, we can have, you know, great kids programs, but if we don't have people praying, it's kind of like the engine of the church, right? It's God answers prayer. So if you'd like to be a part of one of those prayer groups, or if you are not on our prayer list, and you're like, hey, you mean, you know, I would like to get the prayer request emailed, because it's a little hard for me to maybe get some of these things, but I'd like to pray at home. You know, hey, come see me, we'll get you hooked up, and we'll be able to send those go out on Wednesdays, so you'll be able to get an updated, you know, weekly you know, sheet with all the prayer requests on them. So see me if you'd like to be added to that list if you're not on that already. Also, remember that we have our new format in full-fledged glory right now, with our Sunday school time at 9 o'clock and then that fellowship time in between. We'd like to challenge all of you to be able to come out to those. If you can make it to Sunday school, great. We've got some great classes. A lot of people are learning a lot of cool things. So come out for that. If you can't, come out for that fellowship time. You can come be able to enjoy some breakfast together with the saints of God, and be able to have that fellowship around the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you can't make it to those two, we're glad that you're coming out to the morning service. Also, remember that there is a Mark Cable event coming up. You'll see some signs around the building for that. What's it called, Nick? It's called The Great Night Out. That's the name of it. Nick, are you ready for a great night out?
I am still ready for the great night out. The great night out.
Okay, I hope your wife is here to hear that. So, what is it? Concert. Guy plays guitar. He gets some nice songs. He does some comedy. It's kind of be like just a really laid back atmosphere. There'll be some snacks going on, and I believe you'll enjoy that. It's a good time to just invite a friend out. You can just come out for a good night of Christian fellowship and some enjoyment there. So you see those signs around. I mean, we'll be selling our tickets in the back for that. Will be available, and so just hop back there and pick up a ticket for that concert coming up. Also, remember the youth group as they are at their winter weekend, even as we speak. They got up there without any breakdowns, which is an answer to prayer already. I was on the rescue crew for that, so I'm glad they arrived safely up there. But tonight is really their big night. Their last official message is taking place this evening, the last crack the speaker has at them. Then they do a group building time around 11 o'clock after they get done with bowling. And that's a time when kids really bond together and a lot of walls come down and a lot of the issues that the kids are dealing with, kind of come out and the leaders have an opportunity to minister to them. So please be in prayer for the youth group as they have a chance to experience that this evening up there at Arrowhead Bible Camp. And last but not least, where's Jonathan Bortz? Where's he at? Is he around here somewhere? Wait, stand up, Jonathan. Come, what are you? So Jonathan, is part of leadership of the Cornerstone Group. And they are doing a Mexico mission trip. You can sit down now. We saw you. He's doing a Mexico mission trip on June 30th through July 8th. Okay? So that's June 30th through July 8th. And it's kind of, like a little bit of a combined trip between adults and some of the Cornerstone, people. So if you are an adult and you are interested in potentially, taking a mission trip, seeing what missions work is all about this summer, and you're like, hey, you know what, I really kind of feel like that's something maybe that, I would like to do. They have a neat program there where they're going to be doing some construction projects and some ministry to the local community there. Whether you be old or young, there's something for you to do. So if you're interested in being able to go on a mission trip, I hear these kids going on them all the time. I've never been able to do that. Well, Steve Jonathan, there's about 5 spots available for adults, if you're interested. And so Jonathan will have all the details for you. So be praying about that and consider what that is. So again, we have an opportunity to come before the Lord, the God of heaven, the maker of everything, to bring our hearts before him today, to lay our burdens down, and to worship him. He wants to meet with us here in this room right now. His presence is here with us. Forget about everything that has gone on in your mind before you walked in here today. Cast all your thoughts aside and bring your full attention to the Lord Jesus. Have open ears and open eyes to see what he wants to do in your life. Nick. Stand up, everybody. Let's sing together. We're going to sing as loud as we can. Let's start with "When Peace Like a River." Thank you.
Be seated, but continue to stand if you feel so led. It's been amazing to me as I've been finding out the different beliefs that our world holds. It's amazing how many people consider themselves or their brands of what they want to call Christianity that deny the very eternal atonement, the blood. That's the basis of our salvation. That the God who died once for all. And if we believe in that, we have eternal life. Let no one take you astray from that. There is no work that we can do to earn favor with God. We have faith in the sacrifice and the blood of Jesus washed away our sins.
We praise you now, Holy Lamb of God, our restoration. Your sacrifice of perfect love washes us with sins. Our souls were stained as scarlet rose. Our hearts are white as night. But when your precious blood flowed down and turned to us for life. Thank you.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your amazing gift of salvation, your amazing love, mercy, grace. Without it, we'd be nowhere. We thank you for the time that we get weekly to come together as your body and encourage each other and share in the word and in worship. We thank you for the promise of eternity that we worship together forever. To the end of no time. Bless the rest of our service and time together. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Good to see you. Now, I have a hippo at home. I collect hippos. And it holds a sign that says, hard to be optimistic when your fat pants are tight. But now, I want to tell you something. It's easy to be optimistic. When I was born to a mother and a father and five brothers and sisters, physically, when I was spiritually born, I was born to hundreds and hundreds of moms and dads and brothers and sisters. You're here with me today because we are a family. We are one. Someday we'll be with the Master at the table, and I'm looking forward to that. So it's easy to be optimistic. If you open your Bibles with me to Isaiah 42, I'm going to read from 18 to 25, Isaiah 42, 18 to 25. Hear, you deaf, and look, you blind, that you may see. Who is blind but the servant, or so deaf as the messenger whom I send? Who is so blind as he that is at peace with me, or so blind as a servant of the Lord? You have seen many things, but you do not observe them. Your ears are open, but none hears. The Lord was pleased for his righteous sake to make the law great and glorious. But this is a people plundered and despoiled. All of them are trapped in caves or are hidden away in prisons. They have become a prey with none to deliver them, or a spoil with none to say, give them back. Whom among you will give ear to this? Who will give heed and listen hereafter? Who gave Jacob up for spoil, or Israel to plunder? Was it not I? Was it not the Lord against whom we have sinned, and in whose ways they walked not willingly, and whose laws they did not obey? So he poured out on him the heat of his anger and the fierceness of battle, and it set him aflame all around, yet he did not recognize it, and it burned him, but he paid no attention. I ask the ushers to come forward. You open up your order of service at the bottom You'll see missionaries of focus. I'll give you a few minutes to pray for them and pray what's appropriate in your heart, and I will close in prayer. Let us pray. Lord, another week is here again. We bow before you as a family, as a group of believers whose hearts are turned towards you. Help us, Lord, right now, before we start to have everything put out of our minds, the business of the day, the worries of the world, the concerns that we might have right now, and help us to open our hearts to you and let you flood in. For, Lord, you are a great and awesome God. You have forgiven us many things, and you've forgiven us many things to come. You love us to the point of your son's death. You consider us even when we weren't considerable, and you found compassion when we had nothing worth the compassion to have compassion on. You are a great and heavenly Father. You have made us. You have created us from nothing. And yet we thumb our nose at you and we despise you. We do not hear you. We do not listen to you. We do not obey you. Oh, Lord and Master, please have mercy on us and forgive us our shortcomings. I thank you, Lord, for this church that we can come together as a family. I thank you for this time that we could set aside each week to come together as believers to worship you. Please continue to bless this building and bless this congregation. I thank you, Lord, for the leaders we have here in the pastors that could preach your word and tell us more about you, the great and wonderful God. I thank you, Lord, for our nation, that we had the freedoms to say the things we could say, to have the liberty to meet and not have to worry. Lord, I pray for our leaders in this nation that you would bless their lives as well. Lord, I thank you for everything, great things you've given us, and also thank you, Lord, for all the sickness and illness you've given us. It helps us to trust in you more, helps us to lean on you more. In our weakness, we're made strong. Help us, Lord, to seek them out, to seek out your mercies, to seek out your love in our weakness. Help us to be a blessing to others when we're but nothing. I pray, Lord, today our hearts will be attentive to you, and Lord, I help our hearts to be open to you. Please bless the monies that we'll be taking in that we could bless the world with it. And Lord, help us to leave here with more wisdom than we can and more compassion for one another. In your name I pray. Amen.
The deacon in Jerusalem. They dragged him out of those city gates to try and find him. When Stephen preached, those Pharisees started throwing stones. Oh, he died, he raised it up, and saw Jesus on the throne. He said, "You can die, but the world will go on." Thank you.
Pretty good. That was a great message to it. I don't remember that for the Wild Game Supper. Hey, Lauren, remind me of that next year. Hey, get up and greet somebody. You can't sit down after you just heard a great song like that. It's great this morning to see our matriarch here, Dottie Johnson. Dottie, wave, 102. There you go, get it? She was a little bit under the weather for a couple weeks, but you're like the first robin of spring. How about that? It's good to see you, Dottie. I have a story for you about an elderly lady. There's an elderly lady who was standing on a busy street corner, and she was a little hesitant to cross because there was no traffic signal. And so while she's waiting by the road there, a gentleman came up beside her and asked, "May I cross over with you?" Well, relieved, she thanked him and took his arm. But the path across the road they took was anything but safe. The man seemed to be confused as they dodged traffic and walked in a zigzag pattern across the street. When he got across, the older lady said, "You almost got us killed. You walk like you're blind." The man said, "That's because I am. That's why I asked you to cross with me." Jesus Christ asked in Luke chapter 6, verse 39, "Can the blind lead the blind? Shall they not both fall into the ditch?" And normally when we talk about spiritual blindness in the Word of God, we equate it with lost people, the Pharisees. But in our text this morning in Isaiah 42, if you want to turn there, God lays out a charge of unparalleled spiritual blindness on the part of those who should have been his people. A great blindness that had come upon the nation of Israel, upon those who called themselves his people. And he makes this charge of them being deaf and blind in verse 19 of chapter 42. That's where we're going to jump in here this morning a little bit. We'll be staying in these first couple verses here pretty much. But God says, "Who is blind but my servant, or deaf as my messenger whom I send? Who is blind as my dedicated ones, or blind as the servants of the Lord?" Now, if you remember when Pastor Jeff was here last week, he started out in the beginning of this chapter, and we saw that he talked about, "Behold my servant whom I am uphold." And there in that passage, when you come to Isaiah and "my servant" is mentioned in the book of Isaiah, there's three possible identifications. The first "my servant" in Isaiah that you can see is King David. The second is Israel. And the third is the Lord Jesus Christ. And in this chapter, he really compares his servant Christ, the coming servant, with his servant Israel. So in this chapter, you see him laid out, that Jeff laid out for us, the servant of the Lord, now compared to God's people. So you have the servant versus servants of the Lord. And he lays out a charge
before them, and we'll see if I can get this thing to work. There it is. Oh, went too far. Went too back too far. There we go. This is why I don't use these things, you see? The charge of being deaf and blind, verses 19 and 20. For they see many things, but do not observe them. Their ears are open, but they do not hear him. Remember, we have the servant of the Lord in the beginning of the chapter that Jeff talked to us about. The Lord Jesus Christ, the one who sees all, the one who hears all, the one who knows all. And now in the second part of this chapter, God compares him to his servants, Israel, and their rebellious servants who are blind and deaf. They're servants of God who don't pay attention at all. And it's just not Israel that's involved in that. It's many of those who call themselves God's people today. Some saved, some unsaved. Some who call themselves Christians. God here is trying to awaken them to a new day. What he says in verses 14 to 16, he said, I will lay waste mountains and hills and dry up all the vegetation. I will turn the rivers into islands and dry up the pools. I will lead the blind in a way that they do not know and paths that they have not known. I will guide them. I will turn the darkness before them into light, the rough places into level ground. These are the things I do, and I do not forsake them. He says, listen, my servants, the house of Israel, those who call themselves my people have become deaf and blind. But God does not abandon. He charges them. They're responsible for their failures. But he's sounding the alarm. He said earlier, you know, I kept silent for too long, but now, as a woman in travail, the birth time has come. His patience is nearing an end. Isn't it difficult when you go through life and you feel like nobody's listening to you? And don't we yell and get upset? How many of you here have yelled at your weed whacker? You yell at your car, you yell at your lawnmower. And then the ones that are most unresponsive at all, you yell at your kids. Right? We yell at them almost as if we expect them to answer us. Again, here God says, that's what's happened to my people. I want to be their guide. I want to, as Jeff went through with us, and, you know, look at that. Look at how adorable that guide dog is, the service dog. I am fascinated by service dogs. You know, and the things that they can train dogs to do, you know, to see for people, to hear for people. They have guide dogs that can tell when people are going to have, medical emergencies. People who you know, have seizures and things. The dog can sense it coming and warns people. Isn't that amazing that a dog can do that? That a dog can be our eyes, that a dog can be our ears? It's amazing what they teach those animals. And I've been fascinated by it. But how much more that God says, I can be your eyes and ears. That though we're dead and lost and in darkness, in our sin and degradation, God says, I'm going to bring you out of that. Jeff took us through the first 9 verses, and in verse 6 it says, I am the Lord, I have called you in righteousness. I will take you by the hand and keep you. I will give you as a covenant for the people, a light for the nations, to open the eyes that are blind, to bring out the prisoners from the dungeon and from the prison those who sit in darkness. Isn't it wonderful that God delivers people from blindness and from deafness, spiritually speaking, physically speaking. In every way, God says, I want to take you by the hand. But you compare and contrast this servant of God who comes and is going to do this for you, this faithful servant of God, with those that should be his servants, his people. And though we have access to the direction and the guidance of the Lord so often, we're not what we ought to be. He says, who is blind but my servant, or deaf as my messenger whom I send? As servants, we're to be living for the Lord. We're to be taking his hand. We're to be conscious of all that he's taught us, all that he's given us. We should be seeing things that the rest of the world cannot see. We should be worshiping him and serving him. But we're not. That's not what we're doing many times. Israel says, my messenger. Israel were to be a representative of God and to be sharing with the nations and the Gentiles and all around them. They were to be proclaiming the goodness of God. But they weren't. He says, who's as blind as a person who's been exposed to all the truths of God's word and yet ignores them, and yet pays no heed to them, and yet pays no attention to them? And many this morning in America who call themselves Christians are giving no real, genuine heed to the Word of God. I hope better things can be spoken of Bereans here this morning, because we are an enlightened people. Paul wrote to us in Ephesians chapter 5, verses 8 and 9. He said, for at one time you were in darkness. At one time we couldn't see. But now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of light is found in all that is good and right and true. We were children of the darkness without Christ. We stumbled about and didn't have any real sight, didn't have any real understanding. We couldn't hear the truth. We couldn't acknowledge the truth. But when we were brought out of that light, then we're supposed to walk like we can see. How often we don't. And can you think, as you think of being children of the light, children who have been given spiritual sight and spiritual hearing, is there any sadder charge than that God should say to them, to us, to believers, who is as blind as my servants? How sad when those who call themselves followers of the Lord have no spiritual sight and are blind and aren't leading others and aren't proclaiming the truth and aren't living it in their lives. Taking everything that we've been given for granted. That was the problem with Israel. We can look at them and say, man, these are the people that God brought out of bondage. These are the people that he brought out with a strong hand. He brought them out of Israel and he took them into the wilderness. And they saw the sea parted. They saw the 10 plagues that fell upon the Egyptians. They saw God do miraculous things to them. They saw God bring them into the land of promise and give that to them. The land flowing with milk and honey. And yet, what do? They keep falling away. They keep going into spiritual blindness. They keep going back into the darkness. Is there anything sadder than that? Verse 20 says, oh, my servants, they see many things, but they don't observe them. Their ears are open, but they do not hear. Is that a charge that could be leveled against us? Is that a charge that could be leveled against the body of Christ today? Sadly, I think very much so. Why? Because we have these selective senses. How often we are blind to what is really important in our lives. The things of the Lord should take preeminence over everything else. But sometimes we don't see the obvious. Sometimes we don't see the things that are right in front of our face. Sherlock Holmes. Anyone remember Sherlock Holmes, Dr. Watson, right? If you're in Boyertown, Sherlock Holmes is not a row of houses, okay? Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson went on a camping trip. And after a good meal, they laid down for the night and went to sleep. Some hours later, Holmes awake, wakes up and nudges his faithful friend Watson, and he says, "Look up and tell me what you see, Dr. Watson." Dr. Watson replied, "I see millions and millions of stars." And Holmes says, "Well, what does that tell you, Watson?" And Watson thought for a moment. He said, "Well, astronomically, it tells me that there are millions of galaxies and potentially billions of planets. And astrologically, I observe that Saturn is in Leo. And horologically, I deduce that the time is approximately 3:15. And theologically, I can see that God is all-powerful and there are small, and that we're just small, insignificant creatures. Meteorologically, whew, I suspect that we will have a beautiful day tomorrow." Watson face says, "Why, what does it tell you, Holmes?" And Holmes says, "Watson, you idiot, someone has stolen our tent." You see, sometimes we just don't see the obvious, do we? Did you get that? Things in there. Okay, they were camping out. It's Israel had seen. They had heard. They had been privileged to things that the rest of the world had no idea about. And yet they had gone deaf. And they had gone blind. And you read these texts today, what does this mean to us? Well, how much do we see spiritually? How much do we hear? You know, this is a problem with people on down to the ages. This will come. When Jesus comes to earth, and he comes in that first advent, and he comes, and he lives, and he does miracles, and he walks with them, and he talks to them, and what would happen? Most of the people would reject him. He would do miracles. He'd walk on water. He said, "He does these things by the power of Beelzebub." He raises people from the dead. He does great miracles, and they reject him, and they seek to kill him. And they will not listen to his message. Now, there were people who had a spirituality about them, but it didn't bring any real life-changing impact upon their life. And we constantly have to look at ourselves and examine ourselves, saying, how much impact do the things of God have upon my life? Or are they just nice stories that I've heard? Have I gone blind to them? Or the spiritual things in my life just taken for granted? They're just part of the background. I get a laugh at that commercial all the time. It's for Breeze or one of those, you know. And they say the person has gone nose blind, you know. Oh, she's got a cat in her house. What? Everything's still fine. No, you're gone nose blind. This thing has been around you so much that you take it for granted. You don't even notice that it's there. And I think far too often we look at the things around us, we look at our community and we fail to see people. We look at our friends and our neighbors and relatives, we fail to see these people as lost. We fail to see a world around us that is in darkness. Why? Because part of the time is we're dabbling in darkness as well. Sometimes we listen for appeals for help in the ministry, but we fail to hear the Spirit's call upon our life for us to get involved. We're so busy living vicariously through other believers. Isn't it great what my church is doing? Isn't it great what certain people are doing and my kids are doing? But what about you? What are you seeing? What are you listening to? We can see the blessings on those living for Christ. And we see the curse upon those who don't put into practice the things of God, those who ignore what God says to them. And we see how their lives are devastated, but we don't pay attention to it. It doesn't make an impact upon us that often. And that's the charge that Isaiah, through the Spirit of God, is making to Israel. That's the charge that we should look to for ourselves. We need to recognize that the body of Christ today is diseased with indifference and inattention. And a lot of that, I think, comes from living life in the lap of luxury here in the States. That doesn't happen in places where the church is under powerful persecution. Do you think that Christians living in the Middle East right now, Christians living under the domination of ISIS, do you think that they're sitting in the lap of luxury? Do you think they're not attuned to spiritual things? I can tell you they are, because their lives are on the line every single day. They are not indifferent. Those that are indifferent have long ago renounced the things of Christ. Ezekiel 12, verse 2. God said, Son of man, you dwell in the midst of a rebellious house, who have eyes to see and see not. They have ears to hear and hear not, for they are a rebellious house. Every time I read passages like that, I look at myself and say, am I part of a rebellious house? Am I part of an inattentiveness? One of the problems that my wife will tell you that I have is that when I start to watch television, just one of them, that's smart alecky. One of the problems I have is just one? Just one pastor? I don't even live with you and I can name about 10. What? Well, but one of the things girls complain about is, you know, if I start watching TV, maybe you have something like this. I've passed it on to at least one of my daughters. That you're watching TV and people can talk to you and you completely tune them out. You're so engrossed in what's on TV. You're like, and your wife's over here, and after a while I hear this, and I'm going like this. And she's like, hey, I have asked you this 5 times and I'm watching TV. So we get so engrossed in something. And my wife, I suppose, is more important than television. At least sometimes. No, all the time. The thing is, what have we gotten engrossed in? Or, you know, where is our attention? Is our attention on the things of the Lord, or is attention on the things of the world? Have we grown inattentive to these things that we take so much for granted? We throw our Bibles on the car seat. We throw them on the chair at home. We don't open them up. We don't really focus in on things of the Lord. We have all these wonderful privileges by His hand, and yet we're deaf and blind to His claims upon our life. We have to ask ourselves, have we lost our vision? Do we really care about spiritual things? Because Proverbs 29:18 says, where there is no vision, the people perish. But he who keeps the law, he is blessed. You know, where there's no vision, where there's no sight, where there's no understanding, bad things happen. People begin to perish. And one of the things that the church in America needs is people who are sold out, who are excited, who are focused in, who see, who understand, who hear, and who act upon those things. Robert Bella, who is a sociologist who teaches at the University of California at Berkeley, which is by far a very liberal institution, but he is extremely interested in the influence of religion on the community. In an interview in Psychology Today, he said, we should not underestimate the significance of the small group of people who have a vision for something, who have a vision for a new world, who have a vision for a changing world. And he's talking about church people in particular. The quality of a culture may be changed, and here's what their study said. The quality of a culture may be changed when 2%, just 2% of its people have a new powerful vision. Now, there are significantly more than 2% Christians in our country and in our communities. And the question is, why aren't we having more of an effect? See, we tend to think, oh, there's not enough of us. And yet studies say, if you have a group, 2% of the people have a vision, the others will follow. They can make a profound impact upon their group. By the way, that story comes from something John Stott wrote in Christians, Salt and Light. That we're to be salt and light in our communities. We can have salt. We have salt when the rest of the world doesn't. But there's a charge against us. That we are deaf and blind. And sometimes you got to look at it and say, okay, so what's the cause of being deaf and blind? Look at verse 18 says, hear you deaf and look you blind, that you may see, that you might be able to see. See, verse 18 implies something that you need to see. It implies that if you choose, you can hear and you can see. It's a choice. That the blindness that's in a lot of the body of Christ today and the deafness is there, it's voluntary, it's self-inflicted. Let me ask you something. And it's good the kids aren't here, a lot of them. Who knows who that guy is? How many remember that? What was the television show? Hogan's Heroes. And what was his line? I see nothing, nothing, right? I don't know. Why did he see nothing? Because he didn't want to see it, right? He didn't want to see what the Americans were doing. And actually, if every German were like Sergeant Schultz, we could have won World War II a lot easier, right? It was a hilarious show. You know what? I can't leave him up there while I'm preaching. No, I'm serious. That's a good guy out there. We don't see many times because we don't want to see. And we got to start, you know, the cause could be that are we really safe? You know, some of us could be raised in a Christian home. Some could be coming because of a friend or because of a spouse or something like that. And we really don't see spiritual things. Spiritual things don't mean anything to us because we don't want them to. You know, a lot of the world, and even I think some of our young people are raised up, you know, they think, you know, if I don't know it, I can't be held accountable for it. Is that true? We try to use that as an excuse. Well, I didn't know, so therefore I'm not responsible. God says we're all without excuse, doesn't he? Romans chapter 1, go back and read it. They are without excuse. All of us are without excuse. Certainly, those of us who have been raised in Christian homes are without excuse. We have heard. But you know what the human heart says? John chapter 3, verse 19, and this is the judgment that light has come into the world, but people love darkness rather than the light because their deeds were evil. I run into Christians, you probably too, it doesn't seem like they don't want to study scripture, they're afraid they're going to learn something and they're going to have to change. If they see something, they're going to have to alter their course. If they hear something, they're going to have to react differently. And just the fact that they had the Word of God at their fingertips all of their life, they lived upon them, they live vicariously through others, they have no desire, they really don't care what's going on. And I want you to know that for those of us here in the United States of America, those of us here that would call ourselves Berean, if there's deafness and blindness in you, spiritually speaking, it's because you've chosen that. You've inflicted it upon yourself. And a lot of it is because we haven't embraced the light. We haven't laid hold of the insight that we have. Matthew chapter 4, which is it's a reference to Isaiah 9, 1 and 2. It says, the people dwelling in darkness have seen a great light. And for those dwelling in the region and shadow of death, on them a light has dawned. We've forgotten the place of privilege that we have. We've forgotten about the wonders of this fact that God has reached into the darkness and drawn us out and given us life everlasting through the Lord, and we're focused somewhere else. There are people out there today who call themselves Christians and they're not saved at all. They're focused somewhere else. Their focus is on good deeds. Their focus is on some kind of relationship to the church instead of a relationship to Jesus Christ. And they have no sensitivity to the light, to the things that are really, really important. It's what do you take notice of in your life? Are you taking notice of the things you like, or first and foremost, are you taking notice of the Lord? One of the things that I've had people say is, you know, we go out and go to the mountains, go up to my place, the cabin, and take people who usually don't do that. They're not hunters and stuff. And we drive around in the car. One of the things you do is drive around the car at dusk and dawn and look for deer and look for animals. And, you know, like, oh, this is a lot of fun. Well, if you love the outdoors, it is. And I say, man, you're driving down the road. My wife knows I do this too. This is number two thing that I do bad. We're driving somewhere, and I'm looking in the woods. And there's a deer in the woods over there. Yeah, I know, you're in the ditch. Because I'm driving and looking. See, how do you see all them? Because your eyes are trained, if you're a hunter, to look for deer that are speaking. How do you see those deer standing in the woods like that? Because of years of practice. Because that's what I'm focused on. Yeah, if you're driving a car and actually looking at the road, you probably aren't going to see that deer standing behind a bush up there 100 yards in the woods. It's all about what you're focused on. It's like a man who was walking down a busy New York sidewalk with a companion, and the buses and trucks were roaring by in the street, taxis were honking, the jackhammers were going from building nearby. Suddenly he stopped and said, "Do you hear the cricket?" His companion, you know, just stopped and astonished. He said, "We need to hear the cricket." Well, the man walked over to a potted shrub, parted the leaves, and sure enough, there among the branches was a little cricket. Continuing down the sidewalk, his companion asked him, "How could you possibly have heard the cricket in all this noise?" And the man said, "Because I was listening for it." He said, "Here, let me demonstrate." And having said that, he reached into his pocket, pulled out a handful of coins, and let them fall to the sidewalk. And of course, of the dropping and the rolling of those coins on the sidewalk, everybody in the area, everybody on the block, stopped and looked. Why? Money. It's something that their ears were attuned to. See, we have to look at our eyes. We have to look at, what are we attuned to? What are we tapped into? And you know, there's so much going on in our life. And there's so many things out there in the world that it's so easy to get our senses focused, to get our attention taken off of what's really important, and we go into this spiritual deafness and blindness. And a lot of it comes just from sheer neglect. Not appreciating all that we have. Taking it for granted. Not seeing it as vitally necessary in our life. We're like people who buy a house on a busy highway or right next to the railroad. You ever see a house like that? You know, the other day we came out to a place and it was on this really, really busy highway, and there's all these businesses. There's this little house stuck in there. And I said, how would you like to live in that place? You know, that's traffic buzzing by your house, and the thing's like right against the road, no yard, no nothing. And they're like 10 yards, it seems like, from the front door 24 hours a day. And I say, you know how people do that? They get used to it after a while. It's just background noise. They go that way. I take people to my place in the cabin, and they go, "Oh, you don't go to electric up there. I can't sleep. It's too quiet." How many of you people need to have a fan on at night or noise so you can sleep in your house? Look, there they are. What is wrong with you people? "Oh, I can't sleep. It's too quiet. I need noise." I don't get that. But see, it's what we get used to in our life, isn't it? I just need to have background noise. Not at my cabin. I don't have electric. You ain't running your fan all night long. It's going to be quiet. It's going to be super quiet. And then you can focus on sleeping. We need to cultivate who we are in Christ. Because you see, Satan, he loves to blind us to these things. He's blind to believers. You think he doesn't work on unbelievers? But in 2 Corinthians 4:4 says, "The God of this world has blinded the minds of unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God." What does Satan do? He throws roadblocks up. He puts blinders on us. He tries to keep people from seeing Christ for who he is, for appreciating God, for understanding God, for pursuing God. He says, what should I do? I got to put things in the way. I got to get them focused on other things. Why would we go back and live like unbelievers? Why would we go back and embrace the things of the darkness and have our attention focused there instead of on the things of the Lord? And some who walk around and say, I got a little bit of religion. I call myself a Christian, but they're totally still blinded. They're blinded into believing that good works, church attendance, being baptized, these are the kind of things that are going to take care of them. You know what? I think I'm going to join the church at Berea. Certainly, that'll take care of me. And look, you can be saved, you can know Christ your Savior, and be really, really dull of hearing, spiritually speaking, and dull of seeing, spiritually speaking. But why would you miss out on all these wonderful things? We look at these stories in Scripture and say, oh my goodness, look at the things that that Israel missed. God done all these miracles for them, and now they've become blind. What's going to happen to them? They're going into captivity for 70 years. They didn't have to be that way. They didn't have to go through that. They chose that because of their ignoring of the things of the Lord. And I'm going to tell you, if you spiritually neglect the things of God, spiritual neglect will lead to spiritual insensitivity. And we don't realize how bad we are. Remember in Revelation chapter 3, we went through that a little bit ago, and says, Jesus said, because you say I'm rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and know not that you are wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. You see what happens in a church when people neglect the things of the Lord? After a while, they go blind and they don't even recognize it, right? Those of us who went and got glasses, we don't realize how much we're missing until you get that first pair, right? I told that story before, you know? And now it's the same thing with the bifocals, only I know it, right? You look at it and go like, my goodness, is everything blurry? It's frustrating, isn't it? I can't read this thing. I was just going out in the office, I ran in there to see about it, and I'm taking it over to the light and holding it, okay, where's my glasses? This is so frustrating to me. And yet so many of God's people are not frustrated with the fact that they're not growing spiritually. They don't have spiritual sight. There's nothing as sad as Christians who can't see things, spiritually speaking. Who aren't being messengers for the cause of Christ. And that brings us to the third thing, the call to see and hear. I'm going to stay right here, verse 18. I don't have time to get to the rest of this. He says, you know, hear, come in, you deaf. Look, you blind, that you may see. There was a woman named Rose Crawford who had been blind for 50 years. She said, I just can't believe it. When the doctor lifted the bandages from her eyes after her recovery from delicate surgery in an Ontario hospital, she wept for joy when, for the first time in her life, a dazzling and beautiful world of form and color greeted her eyes that now were able to see. The amazing thing about the story was that 20 years of her blindness had been unnecessary. She had been diagnosed when she was young. But over the years, there was a medical procedure developed that could bring her sight back. But she didn't know about it for 20 years. For 20 years, she was blind and didn't have to be. We have a call. God says, you don't have to be blind. I command this to you. It applies that we can have it if we seek after it. We need to recognize how easy it is to fall into spiritual blindness. How easily we can be deceived. How easily we become complacent. How easily we just go along for the ride. In the world and in your jobs and in your school, if you don't invest yourself, you don't get anywhere. Do you think it's any different spiritually speaking? Do you think it's a great thing to say, as I've heard said by Christians over and over in my office, you know, Pastor, as long as I'm saved, that's the important thing. Well, okay, as long as you're saved, but is that enough? Is that all? You want to just be saved, but then be half blind? Or as my dad used to say to me, "Jace, you're blind in one eye and can't see out of the other." You know how dads always send you to find something and you can't find it? It's not that you have to, no, it's not there. And then if it comes, if it could have bit you, you'd have been in trouble because it's like right there. We need to realize how quickly it comes, and we need to accept sometimes our spiritual condition. Sometimes we want to refuse to believe that the conditions are as bad as they are. The captain of the Titanic refused to believe that his ship was in trouble. He wouldn't launch the boats. He wouldn't accept that the Titanic was sinking. He wouldn't even see the trouble until water was ankle deep in the mailroom. Only then did it become apparent to him that his multi-layered hull that they thought was invincible had been pierced, and the unsinkable ship was going to sink. Because of that, half of the lifeboats were never launched. Because of that, the call, the SOS, didn't go out that most of those people, if not all of them, could have been saved. But the captain said, "No, we're okay." And we know what the outcome of that was. We need to recognize our spiritual condition and repent of it. Just because we're his children doesn't mean we don't fall under discipline. In Revelation chapter 3, Jesus said, "As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent." Call out to God and ask him for spiritual vision. If you're here, you don't know Christ as your Savior, that's the first thing. God, show me the truth. Open up my understanding. Open up my eyes, my spiritual eyes, that I can see. Open up my hearing that I can hear the Word of God. That it's not just a bunch of religious stuff, but I need to know what it takes to have a relationship with you. That I can know that I have life everlasting. And if you know him, then that I can grow and become more conformed to the image of Christ every day. Remember that story, one of the great stories of the Old Testament, 2 Kings chapter 6, says Elisha prayed and said, "I pray you, Jehovah, open the eyes of my servant so that he may see." And Jehovah opened the eyes of the young man with Elisha, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire round about Elisha. You know, Elisha said, "We're alone, we don't have anything." Elisha said, "You can't see what I can see. Oh, God, show him." Psalm 119:18 says, "Open my eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of your word." It keeps coming back to the word, doesn't it? Studying the word. God, help me to see. God, help me to understand. God, help me to hear. And then once you see it and hear it, then you need to act upon it. By faith, Hebrews 11 says, Moses left Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Moses could act with courage. Moses could stand up against the powers of the world because he said he could see with his eyes, with his spiritual insight, he could see the invisible God. And so can we. He acted upon that which God had revealed to him. And he didn't have any doubt about it. He knew God was in control. See, we need spiritual insight to function in the world and to do the things that we need to do. And I got to end up here. See that guy there fishing? I can tell you something about fishing. Look at this next guy. I told my daughter, one guy there's fishing right, one guy there's fishing wrong. See, if you're going to be successful in the outdoors where it's hunting and fishing, you need to see what other people can't see. That guy's fishing wrong. Oh, he might catch a couple fish, especially if they're stock trout. But he's not going to catch a lot of wild trout there. You know why? Because he's fishing the wrong way. He's fishing downstream. If there's a live trout there, he's seen him and he's gone. This guy's below him. And I can tell you, if you learn how to read a stream, you don't waste a lot of time. You know where to fish. Well, let me put that up there. Let me get to this. Fish is right there. The fish is right there. The fish is right there. Why? Because that's where fish are. They don't just lay anywhere in a stream. You don't just walk up to a stream and throw your worm in and say, there you go. You got to put your bait where the fish are at. How do you know what the fish are at? By having understanding, by having insight, by having studied the streams. How do you see? How do you know? How do you go forward in Scripture? By studying it, by having your eyes open. It just doesn't come naturally to you. You have to learn. Or else, spiritually speaking, you know what? This guy is going to eat a lot more fish than that guy. Now, if you're fishing, you say, Pastor, I don't think you're right. I'm telling you I am. Because I know about fishing, especially trout fishing, because I did it for hours and hours and hours and hours and hours. I know how to catch trout. Much more important is to know how to catch men. Much more important is to know how to see the world. And the only way that you do that is by having your eyes opened, by having your ears open, and studying the stream of living water. Amen? Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your word. Father, we know that we're sinners. We know that it's so easy for us to be distracted by the things of the world. It's so easy for us to fall into this complacency, to not have things make a difference in our life. Father, we don't want to be like Israel of old. And we know that it's just a few would come into a group that they can change it and transform it and give it a vision and cause it to go forward. How much more if a whole church does that? How much more if a whole nation does that? How much more if the body of Christ would have a spiritual revival? Open eyes, Father. Looking to your word, growing ourselves so we have an understanding of the world in which we live, so we have an understanding of the lost, so that we can go to them and be effective in sharing with them the word of God. Father, I pray that everyone here would take this message to heart, would examine themselves, would look and say, have I been spiritually blind? Have I been spiritually deaf? Is there any here who would say, I don't even know Christ is my Savior? And I pray, Father, that they might open up. You might open up their eyes. Give them understanding. The rest of us will already know you, Father. We want to be faithful servants. We want to be servants who pattern ourselves after the servant, after the Lord Jesus Christ, being conformed to his image, having insight, knowing, Father, the world in which we live, and being victorious in it. Being producers for the glory and the honor of the Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Please stand. Thank you.
Father, we thank you for this time when we get to come together and share in your word and grow. Continue to grow us in love and faith and indeed. We thank you for salvation. None of us earned it, but you give it to us freely because you're a good God. Thank you for the love that you give us. May we grow in it, share in it, and show the world your light and speak to a dying world who is deaf, who needs to hear the love of Christ, who needs to see the light shone upon them. May the Lord bless you and keep you and cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you and give you peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Go in peace.